Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Jacko, written by Tom Keneally and read by James Wright. The book is prefaced by this brief note from the author. Gordon Elliott kindly told me many tales of TV Gothic in America. Some of them appear transmuted in this account. Chapter 1. If people ever wondered how Jacko Emptor was the video trespasser he became, they should have seen where he came from. In the country in which Jacko spent his childhood, a person could have travelled 500 miles in all available directions without encountering a single locked door. Those who, against the odds, understood and loved Big Jacko were aware of how this childhood want of locked doors, this paucity of barriers to entry, so drastically directed his later life. You could argue that factors other than locked door deprivation governed the direction Jacko later took. You could claim, for example, that Jacko would not have come to the most crowded and locked-up city of the Western world, to the Rome of its day, if Basil Sutherland, the Australian media colossus, had not raided America. Sutherland chose to found his own network in the United States and invited in the television producer Durkin and his friend Jacko to bring peculiarly Australian telly mayhem to an already vulgarised medium. Starting a new network was, on the face of it, an extraordinary thing even for Sutherland to attempt. It had certainly occurred to no American to try it. It was a given of American culture that the soul was made up of three networks, three apish and like brains with a little supernumerary cerebellum on the side called the public broadcasting system. These were fixed deities, the Trinity and the Virgin Mary. Basil Sutherland, who'd never been governed by such a cosmology, came from the irreverent city of Perth on the Indian Ocean. Perth, after all, had a tradition of doing racy, hectic, barely legal business. Even so, no seer leaning over Basil Sutherland's birth cot in the Perth Presbyterian Hospital could have predicted it. That he would try to break the hegemony and balance of power of the three electronic sisters who held America's, and thus a large part of the world's, mind in bondage. But back to Jacko, who worked for Sutherland. If you were a friend of Jacko Emptor's, you would have seen Sutherland's electronic ambitions as a foreordained mechanism to bring Jacko to the Mecca of locks. I could certainly have foretold it. That Basil would go to all that expansionary trouble just so that Jacko could come to a populous city in a populous nation, a city choked with doors barred not once but multiply barred, triple locked and electronically guarded, not to mention doorman. The city of most bolts, most bars, most locks, most guards. Basil Sutherland existed as a mere trigger to bring Jacko to it. Behold Jacko Emptor, then. Far from his home and his kin, he is at his work in New York, trying, with his cameraman, to get inside someone's walls. He wears a silly pork pie hat, of a kind never found in all his Northern Territory father's millions of acres. Though on Jacko's great loaf, a Stetson might look like a pork pie. He's also wearing earmuffs and a mohair overcoat and a Burberry scarf rustically knotted. The uninformed might say that he dresses in tune with the flippancy of his vocation, the comic but utterly serious business of circumventing doors. The earmuffs and the mohair coat aren't all for comic effect, though. It's bloody cold. Brass monkeys this morning, especially in the cherry picker bucket, which is rising up the face of the Second Avenue apartment block he's chosen for a target. The cameraman and the cable handler, who share with him the cramped bucket of the thing, are both dressed like skiers. The wind is, as it always is around these big city buildings, subtle and circular, a cornering and recurring demon. This is the building he wants to get into, and the cherry picker, paid for by Sutherland, his implement of entry. If Jacko wants to bring a peculiar cold astringency to his genitals, he can look down over the waist-high parapet and see the aimed white dish of the microwave truck looking homely, an electronic half more than 100 feet below. Ecstatic to be trying this new method and drunk with fear, he does, however, in his early 30s, carry a disadvantage. The beginnings of the same gut which 10 years ago he'd hated in his father, Stammer Jack. He's concerned about how, once he has parlayed entry to someone's apartment, he'll get from the cherry picker over a 14th floor windowsill. The unwieldy, belly-freezing prospect that morning caused Jacko Emptor to begin muttering his bush mantra. And the man from Snowy River never shifted in his seat. It was grand to see that mountain horseman ride. Through the stringy barks and saplings on the rough and broken ground, down the hillside at a racing pace he went. And he never drew the bridle till he landed safe and sound at the bottom of that terrible descent. "Give me a break," said the cameraman when Jacko finished. The man's smoky disdain rose in a cloud above the cherry picker. He was such a sour bugger, this freelancer. Vixen 6, Basil Sutherland's New York channel, had used him only once or twice before. And he told you as fast as he could that he had 5 kids by 2 marriages. This to explain why he considered some jobs too risky or ill-paid. He wouldn't have been here if poor old Clayton didn't have the flu. Clayton would, of course, try anything Jacko or Jacko's producer Danny suggested, even at the pain of having his camera and his person attacked. Whereas this bloke, anything other than straight camera work in clear weather on a flat surface, and he was up to the corner to call Durkin in the studio and negotiate an extra fee. "I'm freelance," was his cry. "He doesn't belong to anyone," Jacko had murmured to Danny, his producer. "Especially not to himself." Arrived on location this morning, and having seen the cherry picker rig come down the Dawn Street, the cameraman said in his tight, convinced of malice way, "No one said cherry picker." And then he was off to the corner. Could have used Danny's phone, but didn't want anyone overhearing his negotiations. 3 jobs passed, Jacko had christened him Fart Features. Now the bugger was complaining about the man from Snowy River. "That's Banjo Patterson," said Jacko. "Great Australian balladist, you ignorant bastard." And Jacko persisted then. "He was right among the horses as they climbed the further hill, and the watchers on the mountain standing mute. Saw him ply the stock whip fiercely. He was right among them still as he raced across the clearing in pursuit. Then they lost him for a moment where 2 mountain gullies met." This, Jacko's talismanic verse, was better not intruded upon. He uttered the verse with a big, forced smile, apparently genial, in Fart Feature's direction. Jacko had some special gifts, and the sparing use of contempt was powerful amongst them. The unhappy camera oaf would, however, be responsible for guiding Jacko over the windowsill and into the chosen room, so that a certain fraternal feeling had to be maintained in the bucket of the cherry picker. "I am for the moment being dishonest, relaying events from Jacko's point of view, as if I knew quite what that was. I am, as you'll see, his friend and confidant in 2 cities, and have enough vanity to believe I know him. So, for a time, I will persist in it. I know how delighted he was with the cherry picker, the supreme device of trespass. I was always attracted by the hubris and triumphalism of all this. Jacko in a bucket on a hydraulic arm, going vertical in his desire to bypass all the locks. Under my H-1 visa, I lived a more orderly life than Jacko. I was allowed to teach at NYU, holding seminars in a room above a deli in University Place, for as long as I wanted to. I had a reputation for being good at teaching graduate writing classes, the sort of class which is rare in my native land, but is found everywhere in the United States. I had no internal knowledge of how my reputation had been achieved. I shared the city with a wife as tolerant and generous as Jacko's wife, Lucy, appeared to be to Jacko. We, my wife Maureen and I, were not in New York all the time either. We returned to Sydney every year for at least 5 months. Given that Sydney was such a pristine city, I should have been a very contented man with my two wonderful locations. But I was unhappy somehow with my own writing, with my publisher, and with my purely literary prospects. This is typical of people who follow my craft. There are only a few novelists of my acquaintance who are pleasant human beings meant for inhabiting families. For most, the measure of their happiness is the perceived state of their present work or the likely critical and commercial response to their last. Even delusions concerning the quality of what they're writing utterly govern their sense of well-being or their lack of contentment. We are, therefore, like alcoholics, and some of us make the comparison incarnate by drinking to celebrate or to soothe ourselves for shifts in talent. In that winter, I found comfort in the company of unreading berserk Jacko, and in the mornings would get up unrefreshed by a furry, starting, unsettling whiskey sleep, another rewrite of my novel on China awaiting me. And I'd scratch myself and watch Morning Manhattan for a distracting sight of my turbulent friend, Jacko. Though vertigo and his bulk might make him graceless at the sill that morning, he possessed, as his spiritual model, the man from Snowy River, who had ridden up and down vertical descents for characteristically antipodean motives, the approval of his mates in the male world. Things were, of course, different in New York. The approval that counted here was the approval of hard-nosed, talented young women, the kind Jacko was always in trouble for calling girls, who were the centurion producers of New York morning television. Jacko would speak to me of how they'd watched their strenuous mothers expose the vein of fatuousness in their fathers, quite successful men outside the home, but eunuchs within. These girls had an eye for that seam of stupidity in every man they met from the age of 5 onwards. Danny, short for Danuta, Jacko's producer, seated now in the production van below, was the paradigm of such wonderful but well-armored women. She was barely 25, a graduate of a communications school in Southern California, and full of acrid ambition. It was worth your while not to be indeliberately flippant with Danny. Generally, as site producer, she accompanied Jacko past the doors and barriers, but there wasn't room even for someone as small-boned as Danny in the cherry-picker bucket. Video was the technology she seemed to have been born to and which operated today. She would talk to the cameraman, who had earphones. She would have two pictures to choose from when they went to air, the one provided by Fart Features once she started running the tape, and the one from the camera crew on the roof of the opposite building. Both she and Jacko had little plugs in their ears through which Durkin, producer-in-chief back at the Vixen 6 studio, could speak to Danny and Jacko. The age of tongues had come. The age of many voices in the head. It had supplanted for Jacko the age of his father's cattle, the outrageous proteins of beef amongst which Jacko had been born, and sometimes in adolescence feared he would be sunk and lost. Here, in view of his producer Danny's feelings for him, we have to look flatly at the truth, which will be richly validated by this account. Jacko had not even addressed himself to the earnest struggle for self-perception which most really modern people were embarked upon, especially in this city of locks. It had not yet come to him that men who said persistently and in all company how much they loved women were in fact misogynists. Jacko took not only his bones from Stammer Jack Emptor and from Australian maledom, but as well a sort of half-chosen incompetence at sorting out the apparent polarities, desire and fellow pilgrimhood, which connected and confused man and woman. He shared with and inherited from Stammer Jack the habit of confusing lust with tolerance, but then between peaks of sexual frenzy, of being frankly bewildered. Urban and urbane men in New York applied themselves to the mystery. In Jacko's tradition, though, you knew you couldn't get anywhere with the mystery, and you went away and drank instead. In New York, the Jacko and the cherry picker bucket had actually been encouraged in these habits. Irrespective of his marriage of a year and a half, and the bride named Lucy...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.